Blog Talk Radio.
Good morning and welcome to TimeToPlay.com's Empower Half Hour. Time to Play is a not-for-profit corporation with the short mission is to inspire everyone to enjoy life, and that's what we're doing today. My name is Doreen Guma. I am a board-certified healthcare executive. I've worked in the healthcare field since 1987. And have seen the sick and sad and decided that we're not going to have sick and sad because we're going to empower ourselves to enjoy life. And that's how this whole thing started. I am a certified professional life coach as well. So we're here to motivate our people for a half an hour. And with me, I have Ruth Curran. Good morning, Ruth. You want to say
Good
a few
morning,
words?
Good morning, Doreen. Sure. I'm Ruth Curran. I am a brain and behavior specialist, and my personal mission is to help people find ways to enjoy their life, to amplify their life, to turn up the noise. And one of the things that we do in this podcast is try and find people who do just that.
Absolutely. And just for information, we do, if you go to TimeToPlay.com, we also have the domain, it feeds the enjoylifeproject.org because we are not-for-profit. But Ruth writes articles, I write articles, Michael Waterman, who is online with us. Michael, good morning. Michael is our makeup and beauty expert. He is our co-creator for the I Can Be Extraordinary makeup line, which is empowerment. We have a unisex fragrance as well that's essential oil, so you could go check that out. And there's a lot of reasons behind why we put that together. And Michael is with us this morning, and so is our guest, Judy Bonilla. Ruth, do you want to introduce Judy?
Yeah, Judy Bonilla is a gerontologist who I have had the pleasure of meeting and working with. And Judy, do you want to tell us a little bit about your work and who you are and your purpose?
Well, most certainly. Thank you, Ruth. My name, again, is Judy Bonilla, and I am a gerontologist and social entrepreneur. I'm also enjoying my encore career, which I think speaks to a lot of people who transitioned into another field and are looking at, again, as you called it, empowering ourselves. We know life is always changing. However, when we're in the middle of it, it's not always easy, and that's what I found and really what moved me into the field of gerontology. I'm the youngest daughter. And I'm actually the last person in my family. So I early on experienced changes with aging parents, and I really thought, I really do not want anyone else to have to feel they're alone in this journey. I just happened to be the first one of my peers. And that is truly what led me into the field of gerontology. And in pursuing that career, I found so many gaps in services and programs and for me in thought leadership. As you know, there's hardware entrepreneurs, there's software entrepreneurs, and social entrepreneurs, what they have in common with those individuals is that we see a gap, and because we're doing this on our own, we're not a part of any large institution, we can actually make changes. And that's really where I've taken my practice to.
That's an interesting concept, Judy. Yeah, the social entrepreneurship, using social entrepreneurship as a way to lift people up and to empower them. So you're empowering yourself and empowering others in the process by finding the gap.
Most definitely, most definitely. And it's interesting. We've spoken a bit before, the way it started off was me developing a transportation program. I personally have been lost and I think maybe lost and found, let me add, in over 100 countries. So I know what it's like to try and use public transportation.
Oh, that's something we have in common, I've got to tell you, Judy.
Add to the mix being 80 years old.
Exactly.
God bless you. That's amazing.
Exactly.
No, Judy's not 80.
Yes, I'm not 80.
You're,
oh.
No.
Judy's not 80, but Ruth is suggesting that, you know, this is an issue where, and you know what, we had a brief conversation prior to getting online. Now, let's just go back just a teeny
sure.
bit, firstly. This is something that we really do need to look at, because we do look at the demographics that the senior population is going to be growing from 43 million in 2012 to 43. Wait a second, I'm totally lost. It's a huge population of our seniors, and this is something that's been coming. They have like a D-Day date of 2035, I believe, where 2020 is to increase to 55 million.
That's all when the baby boomers will all hit 65 and 70. That's true.
Exactly.
Right.
When, you know, I've worked in skilled nursing homes since the year of 2001, and our goal is to always get the people to be independent, to get them back into the community. Unfortunately, and that's why, you know, I do a lot of presentations to senior centers and other things, because one small change can keep a person independent. But that's not just for seniors, that's for anybody. So we do have the time to play philosophy: happy, healthy, have money, work life balance, to have quality of life. So in this respect, as Judy is saying, and I'd like you to expand more on this, about being in 100 countries and seeing the needs for transportation in Manhattan, and Michael works in Manhattan, there is a huge transportation network. And it
sure.
still might
and
be
even
hard
out
for
here
seniors.
In counties, and it's
exactly.
hard.
In,
those people don't
in
know
Suffolk
how
County,
to travel.
There's nothing.
The maps are very confusing. I take public transportation, so I can tell you, people, I see them running around the subway, running around the Long Island Railroad tracks. They're too scared to talk to a conductor or what have you, and they get on a train, and they're not sure where they're going. It happens every day. So, Judy, I commend you, because it's a very, very difficult and growing problem.
And what's interesting is I'm actually a member of the Association of Travel Instructors. There is an international organization whose sole purpose is to teach individuals how to use public transportation. Most transit organizations do fund these programs. They are often small. San Diego happens to be one of the largest cities who does not. So I saw this gap and started my own, voluntarily teaching people the skills that I knew, and then went on to receive training. And actually, I'm proud to announce that this year I was named Practitioner of the Year.
Wow.
And that's fabulous.
This is the first time it's gone to somebody who does not work for a transportation agency. I actually
this is something I'd like to help you with, since I literally am very travel friendly. I would love to get involved with this.
Yeah, it really, like I say, I think all of us who've ever traveled in a foreign country know how daunting it is to even approach the thought, entertain the thought, let alone get ourselves down to an unfamiliar train station and try to work those machines. Imagine if you have some type of vision impairment or mobility impairment. And here's the interesting thing. Most people over 50 have at least one chronic condition, and it usually happens to be arthritis.
Sure.
So you put yourself into a new situation with no frame of reference, which often, as you spoke to, you see people looking. Usually there's a little bit of, there's terror. You may see terror sometimes, but definitely fear, because it's the unknown. And what my program does, and who I reach out to, are the adult children and grandchildren of my students. They may see their parents starting to limit themselves in driving. They may also be asking, how long can my mom and dad drive safely? And my approach is to begin the conversation of driving retirement, just like we have with financial retirement. we start planning for the time that we will not be able to drive.
And that's tremendous. And again, looking at the different areas across this country, you know, in Suffolk County, again, we're on Long Island, there's a very hard transportation system here. Even if you look at the map, the train schedule to get from Long Island into Manhattan is almost impossible to decipher. I can't do it. Thankfully, I can go on the internet. Not everybody does use the internet, and a lot of our seniors are not very good at the internet at all. But
look what I
you
have
look
to
at
do
other
to get
areas.
To you,
what?
You know?
Oh,
what
I know.
I
it's like an amazing.
I
it's
take
amazing.
A bus to a train station, to another train station, to another train station, and then I get to
no,
you.
No, it's crazy. But the biggest issue, I would even think, is in the middle of the country. I mean, we've been to Vermont, and we've been to other states, and Judy, you can speak to this. I mean, we have a very limited transportation system here, but there's other states across this country that have, like, worse.
It's true, and, you know, we talked a little bit earlier. One of the biggest takeaways that I'm hoping your listeners will act upon is they need to become civically engaged, and that means to vote. I've done some advocacy in Washington, and what I do know is that politicians want to keep their job, and
mm-hmm.
who they listen to are the people who vote. And it's interesting in this, you know, I love this country, but I've lived in other countries, so I've been able to look at it, I'll say, with different eyes. And we often do not, we never tackle the prevention of things. We've known that baby boomers were going to hit in big droves from the moment we were born in 1946,
mm-hmm.
yet there's
mm-hmm.
very little infrastructure, and you've spoken to that. So now we're going to have to play catch-up, and who's going to help budget for that? It's our elected officials. So we need to vote consistently. And we also, and this is a fascinating part about this time in our culture. There are individuals like me who are social entrepreneurs who are working for the good and building communities of like-minded people who say, we need better. This is going to be happening in our lifetime, and we need
mm-hmm.
to take steps. The great thing is that the millennials, the grandchildren of my students, are making that bridge because they're now pushing public transportation. They're now looking for alternatives such as ride sharing. You know, we have Lyft, Uber's been in the news, but they're alternatives to driving. And that's where I see a synergy between the eldest and this next generation.
Oh, it thankfully that these programs have begun, and I appreciate that. On Long Island, we have a thing called the Silver Jitney. It is a funded program in our community. It is not available to everybody because I do think it goes by revenue. And the biggest problem here, and I know in other areas, I'm sure, Ruth, by where you live too, is if you don't have a car, you're out of luck. Thankfully, Michael lives in a good transportation area for public transportation. But here, you know, if you don't have a car, you have to be in walking distance. We have a thing called Meals on Wheels, which will help people to get food two times or three times a day, whatever, they bring them food. But, you know, there's no easy way for people to get around. And, you know, that is a tremendous problem. Working in the geriatric industry as well, like I said, since 2001, you know, it's really hard for a person to maybe go to the doctor or just go to the food shop, you know, food store. What do you do? And thankfully also there is, like, a lot of the food stores do delivery and stuff now, but you know what? People are social. And if they're not able to get out.
Yeah, exactly. That's the perfect story. That's perfect point. When you get to it, it's not just about food. It's not just about going to the doctor. It's about having interaction with other people. You know, our mm-hmm. health and Judy can speak to this, our health, our brain health, our vitality, our longevity is tied to interaction with other people and is tied to, you know, it's not, Judy and I were talking about this, there aren't options for, there's senior transportation, but there aren't options for evening activities. So I want to go to a poetry reading. I can't get there.
Right.
That's one of the issues, and that's the gaps that Judy's talking about filling with all of these other options, right, Judy?
That's correct. And here's some of the good news. For the basic transportation, a lot of communities and cities and often, I'll say, community villages provide volunteer drivers to meet the basic needs, which is to get someone to the doctor. Those programs rely on community members to participate and take them in their own cars. These individuals are reimbursed for their fuel and are covered by a third-party insurance. So they're starting to bridge the gap, but that is only, I'll say, for the basic shopping, grooming, and business.
I would love, Judy, not to interrupt, but I would love
sure.
a prototype for that because there is nothing like that here, to my knowledge.
And
that is something that I would have definitely have heard of, and we don't, I don't believe, have that in our area. So if
Nashville,
you have
Anthony
the ability.
County have what's called Accessoride.
Mm-hmm.
You can call, and a small bus will come pick you up. However, as Judy has said, those things stop between 7 and 8 o'clock in both Nassau and Suffolk counties. So if you need to go somewhere after dinner or meet friends or whatever, after 7, 8 o'clock, you are in trouble. It's true.
Yeah, but this is a different program.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to hear more about that program, and we can actually post it. I am a member of, in our community, we have a thing called the Senior Umbrella Network,
mm-hmm.
Which is practitioners. So I can spread that news here as well. And I think that that's very interesting, and maybe people who may be listening would also bring those to their communities, this program, because this is something that is not going to cost our taxpayers money. It's voluntary. And then perhaps, you know, we can get those set up across, you know, move it a little bit further. I think it's kind of a neat idea.
Definitely. And this was actually started by the Beverly Foundation, and they're normally implemented through an area agency on aging who funds a nonprofit, and those are dollars that come from the Older Americans Act.
How would Judy, how would somebody mm-hmm. go about finding that kind of program? You know, if for example, if I had a if I had an aging parent in the Chicago area, how would I go about finding those kind of programs?
Okay, we'll use Chicago as our example. What I would do is contact your area agency on aging. They're called AAAs. One of the great resources is the Elder Care Locator, and we'll make sure and have those links. It's eldercarelocator.gov. And what you do is put in your zip code. You can look for, I think it'll have it under Area Agency on Aging. The other thing you can search on is for transportation. And what you're looking for is a volunteer program. And often, like I say, this was driven because there has been a need. And these volunteer programs are usually sponsored by a city entity, a local organization, and they receive funds to implement this program. And it's made possible through our neighbors. These are the mm-hmm. people who volunteer their time and their energy. So that's what I would suggest in the Chicago market. And again, I'm out in California, so I really can't speak to that. So I'm using my model here in California on what I would do if I had to look for a program. And you might even want to enter the zip code and look for volunteer driver programs.
Volunteer driver programs. That's a great thing to look for.
And we, again, we don't have that on Long Island. So what I'd like to do, and I've been talking about this for years, is to put mm-hmm. up a resources page on the Time to Play site, because it is resources for everyone to enjoy life, too. And we'll get these these things from Judy. We'll put this up on there because this is very interesting. We do have an aging association in New York State, mm-hmm. and I can also bring that to them because I think, you know, I haven't, again, I've been part of the Senior Umbrella Network for 10 years. I have not heard anything on this type of programs. In our Long Island area, we have 7.5 million people that do live on Long Island, which is, Michael, do you know how long it is? It's like 100 and something miles long by 23 miles wide. I mean, it's not a very big area.
160 miles long is Long Island. 160.
Okay, thank you. It's a very small area with 7.5 million people on here, and probably not a bad idea to get some of this rocking here, too, because we
do have
a very large population of seniors here. And, you know, driving is an issue, and you take away people's freedom. I personally know somebody, my mother and father tell me about this gentleman all the time. He has diabetic neuropathy. He can't feel his feet, and he drives, and he's freaking scary. You know, we don't want a person like that to drive, but he has no options. If he doesn't drive, they don't eat, they don't nothing. So there is no options for people. Staying social is hugely important. I just wanted to go over some of these brain health things. One of the other things, Judy, that you might as a gerontologist want to touch on is in your program you do have things about walking. Can you talk about the benefits of that?
Sure.
I mean, because that is a form of transportation too. But
it is. And it's so interesting. Like I say, We Get Around is my nonprofit organization that teaches adults over 60 how to use public transportation here in San Diego and starts a conversation on driving retirement. I'm a serial entrepreneur, right? Yes,
yeah.
I saw this need, and what I know about learning, and again, I think the listeners can understand this. It takes brain power to figure out those timetables, those bus schedules, to buy a ticket. You are focused and you are present when you are trying to safely maneuver public transportation until you know the pattern, which is so much about brain health. And that actually is what spurred me to create Brain Fit Now, which focuses on the brain health. And in that program is, again, we for those of us in the field, we know the basics about what makes good brain health. Part of that is moving, that cardiovascular. Our brain needs to be nourished, and the best way we can do that is to walk. So in my We Get Around class, in our trips, because there are trips to landmarks. That's how my students learn how to navigate the public transportation system. We pick a destination, we identify how to get there, and then we actually complete the trip. We walk on average a mile to mile and a half. The great thing about it, it's not all in one go. We'll get on the bus, we'll sit down, we'll get off at our next destination. We'll walk a little bit, so it's intermittent walking, which makes it a great fit physically for seniors who might not have been active. In my brain fitness program, I take that same methodology in that we do lectures and then we'll take a 10-minute walk. So the idea is to build up great habits. So both of these, again, you speak so much of empowerment, and that's truly the focus of both my programs. One, the transportation to empower people to make better decisions for themselves as they age in place. And the Brain Fit Now is to take action where they are right now to improve their quality of life.
It's all about thinking your way through life too, isn't it, Judy?
Definitely.
It's those mental maps and being able to problem solve and figuring out, being able to focus and pay attention to enough of a detail to get from here to there. And it's the great thing about public transportation, and it's a great thing for everybody because, you know, anyone who's concerned about their brain health, is that you have to move to get to public transportation. You have to walk. You have to at least get up and, you know, from the bus stop and get on the bus and walk up the stairs to the bus. You've got to take those few steps where when we drive, we can go from doorstep to doorstep. So public transportation really is a good brain healthy choice.
Most definitely.
It absolutely is.
I'm glad to hear that.
Michael can attest to that because he does walk.
Judy, Ruth, I do it every day, and I walk 8 to 10 miles a day myself.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because of my job, but because of also, when I get off the subway from Penn Station, I get off actually 2 stops ahead of myself, which is a mile, so that I can get, and I can actually see the world, you know, and motivate and interact with other people. And also see what I'm getting into that day. So it's,
right,
I agree with you completely.
It gives you an opportunity to set your intention for that day too, Michael. You know, it spurs whatever you need to think about, and all the chemicals that you're activating when you walk, all those brain chemicals, are making you feel better and think better and focus better.
Without
so
a doubt,
yeah.
I can't tell you. I was 52 pounds heavier 7 or 8 years ago. And I lost the weight. I've kept it off for about 7 years now. And I will tell you that the way I did it was working on portions, but mostly my walking.
Mm-hmm.
My walking is my therapy. It's my meditation. Walking gets me out of anything that I feel miserable about, or I need to clear my head. And I find that that's the best therapy I've ever had in my life. So I'm applauding you guys for. Ladies, for promoting the walking is so important. I know my father's 83, and he just had some surgeries. And one of the things they said to him was, you need to get more mobile. He didn't.
Mm-hmm.
He sat home with a remote in his hand watching ESPN 1 through 7 for about 4 years. And my mother took care of him. It was easy, right? But he endangered his health, and he didn't see it. And my mom is now getting him to do the right thing. But they're in their 81 and 83, and they've had a hell of a time because of my father's lack of movement.
Yeah, and I think
I was going to say this is something that's very important. We do need to stay proactive. As Judy was saying, it's better and easier to pre-do stuff than it is to catch up. Like Michael's dad is trying to recapture, but if we do a little bit. Now, I just wanted to put out some websites. The Brain Fit Now, Judy has very interesting information on here. Definitely should check that out. And then the WeGetAround.org, there's information here for family and friends, for a driving retirement. You know, like the driving retirement idea is very good because if you all of a sudden have a crisis situation where the person's no longer able to drive, now you're scrambling to try to figure out what to do next. But always having that plan, and that's what we advocate for in the Time to Play Foundation. And also on this WeGetAround.org, please do check out the brain health information. It's the Time to Play philosophy, happy, healthy, have money, work-life balance. So with that, Ruth, you want to wrap us up?
I think that the important things to remember from what Judy was telling us about is that you don't have to lose quality of life. I met Judy and listened to her speak, and the one thing that struck me when she spoke is that people lose their power when they lose their keys. If we do that gradually and give people their own choices, they can enjoy their life better. So, but thank you very much for coming, Judy, and anything that you want to add in the last minute that we've got?
Take action today. Start planning today. That's your takeaway. Don't delay. Now is the day to start.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And I want to thank everybody. And please go on timetoplay.com to get some more information about what we do for the foundation. And Judy, we're going to follow up after the podcast, and I'll get some links and things from you so that we could post it up on the website as well. So thank you for joining us today, and empower your week and learn what you need to know so you can enjoy your life. Thank you, guys.
Thank you all. Thank you.